Jackson, better known as Thomas Jackson. Everybody called me Bro for sure. Been called me Bro since I was a little boy. Mama named me Bro. I was the oldest boy in the family, you see. And just like sister, your grandmother, she was the oldest daughter in the family. You know, some people, all the people that been knowing me all my life still call me Bro.
Mary Layla F. Jackson. I'm from Pacifico. And I met my husband, Thomas Jackson, at
Dave's Fair. Who's that girl there? I wonder where she come from. We went up to the place up there, they dancing up there, little dance. They used to dance. They about to get fighting, cutting up, shooting up like they do now. We just out here in front, you know what I mean? And I could get down and dance. And your mama could too, your grandma could too. She said, where you come from? I said, where you stay? She said, I live right down there across the street. I said, you know Baby Doll? She said, yeah. Big dog, that's a big dog, my sister.
Well, you big dog, brother. For a fish sandwich, that's how we met. And he went and borrowed 25 cents to get me a fish sandwich.
Then I told her, come on, dance with me. Good music, song. Who throws whiskey in the well?
Well,
in the well.
Keep those people out of that well.
That well, oh, we all
wind up in hell.
Well,
who throws the whiskey in the well? I left there, went on, I got me and this girl, got married, which is your grandmother. And we had a nice life. And we still together.
Then you want a lot of kids. You didn't tell me how many. But I had 18. And I raised 14. I had 9 girls. And when I had a line full of clothes, the line was full of clothes, but it wasn't one dress a piece. It was more harder with the girls than it was with the boys. And I enjoyed taking care of. When I go to the clinic, you know, to the health center, here come them Jackson girls. Oh, ain't they pretty. Here they come. The boys, all I had to do was just comb their hair, get them a haircut.
Yeah, this is a story.
And celebrate my mother and father's 50th anniversary. My name is Thomas Jackson. I'm the firstborn of the 15 children that my mother and father have had. And I just want to say it's a blessing to be here today. I give God, first of all the honor and praise for keeping me through the years and going through all different areas that the family have been through to get us at this point now. It wasn't a hot summer, just like it was hot this summer. My mama used to cook cakes and hide them deep. Put them all up under the sofa, all behind the sofa. And when she hide them, I'd be around the corner peeping And I just knew where every cake was, chocolate cake, caramel cake. And one day she went to the store, Liberty Supermarket, and I got me one of them cakes, and she had just bought grand big old half a gallon of milk. And I drank that milk and ate cake. I went up under the house. It was real cool up in the house. And I had a whole cake. I just cut my big old piece out of that cake and ate it. And I was drinking milk. I came out, then mama came home. And when mama came home, she said, "Somebody ate my cake. You ate my cake too. I know you ate it. I know you ate it." I said, "Mama, I ate no cake." You know, I told her a lie. And she kept on fussing. So, out of that, about a couple of hours later, my stomach went to falling. I just started to bawl, and then all of a sudden my stomach started to hurt so bad I thought I was gonna die. I said, "Oh, mama, help me. Help me, my stomach hurt me, it's killing me. It hurt me so bad." Then mama told me, said, "Well, come on, get in the car, boy." She forgot all about the cakes were missing and the milk. She said, "Come on, get in the car, boy." She said, told Dad, "I don't know." She said, "Bruh, something wrong with the boy. I got to carry him to the hospital." Dad said, "Give him some Pepto-Bismol." she said, "I ain't gonna give no Pepto-Bismol. Carry him to the doctor." She went out to rush me to drive him to the hospital. And got me at the doctor, and I was laid out on the thing, just hiding. Oh, everybody said, "What's wrong with that boy?" You know, and they kept me back in a room and be real cold in the hospital, you know? And I was laying back down on that thing like on a slab. And my stomach was just boiling, then I found it cool off. The doctor came back there. He said, "Son," I said, "what did you eat? What did you drink?" I didn't want to tell him. He can't ask me again. "What did you drink?" I said, "I ate that cake." "Oh, how much you eat?" I said, "A whole cake and drunk 2 things of milk." I said, "Big one like that." And he said, "That was wrong with you." And so he went back out there and told mama. Oh, well, she came in and hooked me on the table. Beat me all off the table. Man, ever since then, I didn't eat no more cake or drink no more milk for years.
Hi, my name is Dunnies Powell, and I just want to say happy anniversary to Mr. and Mrs. Thomas Jackson. I'm the oldest daughter of 9 girls, and I just want to say that I've been around here for many years, and like I was really the second mother of the family. I helped my mother, you know, try and raise the girls and some of the boys. From a big family, it's mostly being able to get along with different people. Mm-hmm. Because being from a large family, you have a lot of different personalities, and so make you kind of being able to deal with other people.
Hello, my name is Demetrius Jackson, the fourth son of Thomas and Mary Jackson, which is located in Birmingham, Alabama. So here I am in Birmingham, trying to make an honest living. I don't really understand why I can't make an honest living, but what could I say? See, when I was 10 years old, I was a big kid. I was somewhat like the average guy, 16, 17. So I had been driving at least 4 or 5 years. No. I was there a year. So it wasn't a thing whereas I stole a truck like I have heard. My dad trusted me enough to go pick up some sand. And so when I came back, my brother Ron and my sister Von Seal was with me. Von Seal was a little bit of a baby, so we were joking around. And Ron said, "There's the police." I said, "Man, stop jabbering going on." So we went on down, got the sand, came back. The police was back there for real. So I don't know, everybody thought the police were going to take me to jail and all this kind of stuff, but I brought him back home, 10 years old, driving like a 16-year-old. So that was the extent of it. I did not send it or steal the truck.
Now, when you got to high school, I know you played football with your brothers and stuff like that. Were they the best teammates you could have, and what kind of teams did you have in Winona High School?
Well, first of all, we only had one of the worstest records, worstest football records in the county. But my oldest brother, Tommy, made a way, and Kenny came along and made a way for all of us. Now, believe it or not, I have been in the camp of the Redskins and the Jets and San Diego, the World Football League, and have played with some of the finest ball players in the country. But I would like to say this here. Bo Jackson is the closest thing that I have seen to my brother Kenny. The closest thing. And I don't think Bo Jackson was really in his category because Kenny played offense, defense. As a matter of fact, he was a whole team. Ronnie, good ball player, consistent. But out of all the ball players in the family, Kenny was the best by a long shot. There was no comparison. He was in the league by himself. So, you know, coming up with your brothers playing football and baseball or whatever, it's, I don't know. I never felt like I was as good as Kenny, Ronnie, or Jason. But I knew I had more.
Hi, Mom. Hi, Dad. This is your son, your fifth child of the Jackson family. I just want to thank you for having me. Thank God for putting me here on earth to share the things that my family and my sisters and brothers have shared watching you guys do the things that you do the best. I did a wonderful job raising myself, all my brothers and sisters, Demetrius, he ended up playing professional football. Kenny ended up playing professional baseball. Jason went to BYU. Other sisters that played softball and also attended college, like Judy graduating. I just want to say that you guys are the best. You guys are the one that made this thing happen. With raising family just like you, you know, I have a beautiful wife, Cheryl. I have five kids. Three by previous marriage, two with Cheryl, with her kids, and all together, these are my kids. And I just want to thank you for helping me bring together a family and carrying that traits on and making sure that I carry on that tradition. I used to love to go to work with Dad, and one reason why is because Mom, when you stay home with Mom, she don't make you work. She don't make you rake the yard and rake the leaves and all that stuff, you know? And then, you know, when you go to work, you'll get rewarded. But at home, you don't get anything. So with Mary Jackson, up to the big house, I tell you what, up to the big house, you gotta work. If it's washing dishes, cutting the grass, washing clothes, hanging up clothes or whatever, you're gonna work. So I remember one time going down on the baseball field with some other buddies, and now I was supposed to rake the yard, I was supposed to cut the grass, and but I thought going down the baseball field was more important than going to cut the grass. So I was down on the field, and a couple of my buddies came running to me and said, "Hey man, your mom is mad. She's coming down here to whoop you over behind, you know?" And I said, "What?" I said, they said, "You're supposed to be cutting the grass." I said, "Cutting the grass?" "Oh, shut." So I took off, man. Got my equipment and ran across the baseball and ran across the golf course. And by the time she got down there, man, that grass was cut and the leaves were raked. And I tell you what, she was mad, but I didn't get a whipping that day. And I tell you what, that was a story that I'll never forget.
Mr. and Mrs. Jackson, I'd like to wish you a happy 50th anniversary and hope you have many, many more.
My name is LaWanna Jackson Greer. I'm the sixth child.
Any fights with your sisters?
I think that was part of each child being an individual. Mm-hmm. we would have arguments.
Mm-hmm.
But it was all in loving each other.
Who'd you beat up the most?
Well, I remember my sister Edwina. We would get into a lot of arguments at that time.
Mm-hmm.
And by me being the oldest, the other kids would be disobedient, but they had their own, they were trying to, as they were growing up, they were trying to show me that they will listen, but after a certain age, they would have their own mind.
Mm-hmm.
My father asking me, LaWanna, are you ready for school? Speaking of elementary school. And I told him, I don't mind going to school, but I don't know how to read. So he thought that was very smart. And he told me not to ever forget that.
Alfred Jackson, born 12-20-54. Born 12-20-54, Alfred Jackson. Motorcycle ride, Brick Lair. Big house, it's good. Is it Sunday evening?
You always pass the lead on Sunday evening at the big house.
Hey, one of a kind. From Maine to Mexico, I've been there, motorcycle rider.
I don't get no better.
First, give the honor to God for the hell of my life. My name is Edwina. I'm the eighth child. I'm between Nup and Angela. I'm married to Aubrey Robinson Sr. and have two kids, Tamika and Aubrey Jr., and two grandkids, and a son-in-law, Ken Huff. As I say, my mom and dad, they say I was the baddest child, but I don't think so. I was just an outgoing child, an outspoken child when I was growing up. I feel like I'm special because I was born on her birthday. I was born on her anniversary. So I just feel like I'm the special child of the family. She had a grandchild born on her birthday. And then she had a great grandchild. So I feel like all three of us is special too. There's Keith and there's Chep Chep. Woo, Jesus, did I get whoopings. One day, let me tell you this. She said, Mommy, come here. I had done something, I can't remember what I had done, but it was something bad. I took out the run. I was fine too, Jack. Girl, if you don't come back in, I'm gonna throw this knife at you. I thought she was teasing. Shoo, I took out running. That bad girl saw a knife come at me. Shoo. I looked at her and I kept going. But when she got me, then she beat me. Yes, Lord, she beat me. But I thank the Lord for them. They're some good parents. Can't ask for no better parents than my mom and my dad.
Hi, my name is Angela Jackson Tinsley. I've been married for 8 years. It'll be 8 years in September. And I have two kids, Joanna and Antonio. 50 years, can you imagine? 50 years. God been good to them in 50 years. I know all days haven't been good days, and then all our bad days outweighed our good days. The good days outweighed the bad days. But through the years, my dad, he has been a good father to me. He has raised several families. And also, my mom, she's been there when I need her all the time. I live right up the street from my mom. And I think it can cause a little problem because I am very, you know, it's very convenient for me to go down there and eat when I get ready, come on back home when I get ready, you know. I can also go down there, I can call and ask her how to fix something when I don't know how to fix it. She'll say, well, just bring it on down and I'll fix it for you. You know, I was the one that got hit in the eye with some glass when I was a baby. And my mom was washing the dishes, but I was always the smooshy one. And I would come up to the sink and I pulled the glass down. That's what she told me. Now, I can't remember. But she said I hit myself in the eye, broke the glass, and the glass popped in my eye. I put my eye out, so, and I only could see out of one eye. But it never bothered me because I never understood it, and I never known that I could see out of but one eye. But the doctor said that all the strength went to one eye from the other eye, so I have a bionic eye. I don't need eyeglasses. And that's still, I still consider that as a blessing. And my dad always would ask me, Angela, how old are you? I would say, uh-huh. So he said, well, that's the years we've been up here because, you know, we moved up here the next day you were born. So that's how he keeps up with how many years he's been in Ishkuta.
My name is Deborah J. Rucker. I have two sons, Josh and Marcus. Marcus was born in Augsburg, Germany. I'm sitting here at 1720 Cedar Avenue, where I got married in 1983, right here in the yard. My wedding anniversary is July the 9th. It'll be 14 years for me. I remember when we was little, we used to have to Denise, Tommy, and Ken, now they used to make us wax the floor on our knees with a rag. We used to get on our floor, on our knees, and wax the floors and stuff like that. We used to have to go through there to pick up slop and take it to the hog pen. And I remember when we was sleeping at night, we used to have the window up, and cats used to come in. I took a cat and smiled them out the window. Cats used to come in through the window. But this wasn't a house thing. The house was different. I remember when every day my dad used to wake us up. It used to be hot. The hip-toe bricks. We had to put them bricks on a wheelbarrow. I used to stick them through a stick and carry him and help him with the bricks for the house. But now I'm blessed with my own house, and I'm blessed Lord has blessed me with a husband. But I don't have to carry no more bricks. And I've been blessed. I've been all over the world. My husband in the wheelchair, and I've seen lots of places, lots of, you know, things I never thought I'd ever be.
Hi everybody, this is William Jackson up in Kansas City. I'd like to say hi to all of you, my relatives back there in Birmingham, Alabama. Missing a lot down there, but I'm enjoying myself up here in Kansas City too. Now, while I want to say hi to everybody, I'd like to say hi to two people in particular. Thomas and Mary Jackson, want to say congratulations on your 50th wedding anniversary. You've been in it a long time, and I can appreciate all that. Keep it going and keep the good times flowing. Until I see you guys next time, have a good one, and I'll see you when I come visit the ham.
Sweet. I'm Sheila. Out of nine girls, I'm the sixth daughter that was born to my mother and father. You know, there's advantages and disadvantages of being a large, being born into a large family. But some of the disadvantages are, during the time when I was in high school, I remember I would wash my own clothes. And my mother bought all of us five clothes for each day of the week. And every Saturday, we had to wash those dresses out for school. But one thing about it, all of our clothes was clean. My mother installing us to be neat and clean, and all of the teachers at school will always say that you have a large family, Miss Jackson, but every time we pass by your house, there's a line filled with sheets and dresses because we have to wash them each day. But it taught us to share. Not only share, my father installing us to stick together also in unity. So whatever we did, even with playing baseball, this is an advantage that we had. There was a lot of girls where we stood together in whatever we did, but because my father always said, unity, when you have unity, there's strength. There's a lot of times when my sister and I, we will have fallen outs, and my mother would say, who started the fight? That's or disadvantage there, because she wouldn't know. So all of us had to line up against the wall. And at sometimes I would feel as though that I was getting more licks than others. So I said, now she actually know who actually did this, but because I would judge from the number of licks that she gave me, it looked like she gave everybody else one or two licks. And then when it was my time, she gave me 10 or 12. It seemed as though it was 20. So I said, In actuality, I really would have done the dirty deed, but nobody would tell. Nieces and nephews, I'm not married, I do not have any kids, but my nieces and nephews, I guess they are actually the center of my life, and when they take their mother and father, parents through hard times, I can actually feel the pain, and some of my sisters and brothers only have 3 to 4, no, I don't think they have over 5 kids, and I can imagine with one parent having 15 kids and the different difficulty that they carry them through, I can't even imagine how they even bear the pain. I know that from time to time, it had to have been God who had carried them through, because even with the nieces and nephews now, I constantly pray for them, for my sisters and brothers.
I'm Vancil. I am the 11th child out of 14. I had an accident one time with Demetrius, my nephew. Mm-hmm. And he was in the car, he was like 7 months old. I stole the car. And little Angela stayed next door. I carried Angela to the store. And then I went to Church's Chicken in West End, and Demetrius was like 7 months old. I was making a left-hand turn, and this man came around another man and hit us. Demetrius had the biggest eyes in the world. His eyes was just bucking. Everybody kept saying, oh, a baby's in that car, a baby is in that car. So I towed the station wagon, and I was sad. It was December the 14th, and my mother and father, they was upset, but they got over it.
Hi, I'm Judy. I'm the 12th child born to Mr. and Mrs. Mary Jackson. My dad said when I was born, his friends would tease him, say, you have a dozen of them now. The Moore's daughter, her name was Judy Ann. They left off the Ann and just named me Judy. That's 9 girls, and all of our life we've heard people say that you have a softball team, Mr. Jackson. You should have a softball team. And when we grew up, we actually did have a softball team with my brother Jason and Kenny coaching us. I was the center fielder along with my other sisters, Vancil and Edwina. I played center field for about 5 years. I think she's the best cook in the world. She loves to cook and we love to eat her cooking. I was saying that once to one of my friends that worked with me. I said, my mother's the best cook in town. And she said, oh, everybody thinks their mother is the best cook in town. So I had to prove it. So I took her a piece of caramel cake and some egg custard. And she said, Judy, your mother is the best cook in town. After tasting it. I just think he's the most brilliant man I know. He's really encouraged me a lot. You know, and I remember going through college every day. It was how much longer you got to go today. Every day I had some type of encouraging word and I really remember that, and that really sticks to me.
My name is Karen Yvette Jackson, or Karen Yvette Green. My main name is Jackson, and I was Green. Now I'm divorced. I have two kids. My oldest son is Tori Liddell Jackson. And my my youngest son is J.C. Tremell Green. I had Tori when I was young, and Dunnies and Nana always kept him for me, and they was very supportive, my sisters and brothers. And my mom and father was there for me, and my brother Ron, I remember the day he came home, he sent me a box full of clothes for Tori. Yep, I didn't have to buy Tori no clothes till he got about 2 years old. Cause for Ron, he bought Tori clothes from 3 months to about 2 years. So that was a blessing. And I can say I thank the Lord for my brothers and sisters and mother and father. And I just want to tell, it's a lot of things I want to say. Okay, after I had Tori, I got to stay out with my husband. And mom told me, hey, Sugarloo. If you don't get in this house at 12 o'clock, you next thing you know, your clothes gonna be outdoors. You know, I said, Mom, don't throw my clothes outdoors. So, you know, I tried, you know me, I was always they say I'm the black sheep of the family, but I don't think so, God. But anyway, I came in, you know, one day, Mom was telling me, Shiloh, down here, come in this house this time of night. I said, well, what you talking about, Mama? She said, girl, I told you not to come in this house this time of night. This time of morning, because it was about 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning. So what happened? I just like, oh, she should. You know, went upstairs and talking out of my voice, like, I wish she should have talked to me, you know. Went upstairs, the next day I know, I was upstairs, she caught me. Knocked down the door. Everybody running out the room like, dog, what happened? Ooh, Mama kicking her butt. Ooh, Mama whooping her. So she really, you know, she really was strict on me in so many ways, you know, but I really appreciate it. And another thing happened to me when I was younger, before I had Tori. She told me not to do something, I was talking back. Next thing I know, she had a pillow on my head, you know, so, you know, Mommy and I, we go back a long way. She had a pillow on my head. Girl, I kill you. Everybody in the house hollered, oh, Mama, don't kill her, Mama. But, you know, that's just Mom and me, you know, we go back a long way, like I say. But I was like 14 or 13 years old. We had a family thing. You know, everybody come home on Sundays and eat. Judah Ray, Linda, and Tony. I don't think Tony was there, but everybody was sitting at the table. And I said something to Mama. She throwed a box of salt at me. Salt everywhere. Everybody had, you know. When I got it, everybody got it. You in the way, you better get out the way.
Hello, I'm Jason Jackson. I'm the youngest of the Jackson clan. And by being the youngest, birth order kind of detects so many things, but I had a tough act to follow. And then by coming behind all of those girls, I had 9 girls ahead of me, and then by following those girls, everybody wanted to see what this little boy was going to be like. But I think I fared pretty well, and I kind of rose to the occasion. And my mother never ever failed to mention the fact that I was her baby. I can remember going to S&H green stamp place, because my mama used to collect all those green stamps. At that time, when you buy groceries, they give you stamps. And then when you fill up so many books, you can go get toys, and we go pick up toys and everything with those S&H green stamps. But I remember going there and to the bargain town and the top dollar, and I remember her leaving me in the car and taking me in the grocery store. And the only place she would take me is to the grocery store, because she had about 5 carts with all those children. And I would be pushing 2 and she would be pushing 2. And she never failed to mention the fact that I was her baby. And I just hated that, because I did not want to be the baby. And I would always like, oh, Mom, I'm the youngest, I ain't the baby. But she said, that go my baby over there. And so I just remember my mom always saying that when I was young, that I was her baby. My mother was also a strong disciplinarian, and when she told you not to get out that car, I don't care if it was 112 degrees out there, because we ain't had no air conditioners back then in our car, you stayed out there in that car. And at that particular time, I thought my mother had to have been the meanest mother in the world, because she's from the old school. She's one of those old disciplinarian, and was a big lady too. So you didn't challenge her at all. You just did what you were told. But now I can see the value of the discipline that my mom used to discipline us, and it made us better kids. All of the teachers at school, they complimented my mother and my father for a wonderful job that they did with all of us kids, because we were well-mannered, and it threw a positive reflection on the way our parents raised us. My daddy, I look at my dad, and he was kind of the opposite of my mother. He was more mild-mannered. And I remember my dad playing ball with me. Those are some of my fondest memories of my childhood, is just playing baseball. I used to get out there and throw that ball up against the house, and my mom would be hollering, "Stop all that noise up against that house." I remember when school was out doing summer vacation, and most of the other kids went swimming or went to Disney World or Six Flags, I went to work. Because Daddy said if you weren't in school, you were getting up with him going to work every morning. And at that particular time, boy, Mama used to holler, "Jason, get up! Your daddy waiting on you!" And I sat there in the bed hollering, "I could care less. I don't feel like going out there today. It's hot." But I had to get on up. And today, I really appreciate that. I appreciate those. I can't emphasize the fact of how much I appreciate those values, because now that I'm older, I see that those values that my parents taught me was a basic necessity.
Yep. Hello, Mr. and Mrs. Jackson. I'd like to wish you a very happy 50th anniversary, and wish you many more.
I stayed married 50 years, but it wasn't no easy job. You know, we have ups and downs.
But it took a man to hang in there through them downs and ups.
You got to try to come on and stay there. You have kids, you have to raise your kids and everything, and you want to do the right thing.
It takes a real man to under pressure.
It's good to be here. It's just a wonderful thing. And we owe Sister Andrea and me and Riley and me, we all are blessed to raise our children up and see our grandchildren and our great grandchildren. And is it a great mom?
Mm-hmm.
And great great grandchildren alive, because I didn't see none of my grandparents. They all had passed on when I was small. I didn't know none of them. And it's a wonderful thing. Sister had a good mom and a daddy. I know them, a good mom and a daddy. And so they done passed on too. So we just got to try to lay an example for our children to follow by.
No 15 or 16 children. This was not in our hands, it's in God's hand. But it did happen. And every one of them was born. They weren't born, they weren't hungry and having to eat. They were always cared for by their grandfather, grandmother. They're gone on now.
Honey, they're supposed to be having their 50th anniversary sometime in next month, this month or next month.
Mm-hmm.
I can't remember. But anyway, hope I'm happy landing, because I've been a widow for about 34 years. I stayed married 24. Uh-huh. So I'm being blessed now. I've been real sick, but the Lord has brought me back. And I am very blessed, because I had cancer, and now the doctor said that they don't see no cancer nowhere in my blood, in my body, nowhere.
And it was really a joy to have such a family like the one that I am a part of.
I am a grandmother again. And she will be a great-grandmother again, pretty soon, two or three days. So I'm lucky. I'm very lucky. And I wish them the best on the anniversary.
Imagine what we had taken our parents through in the time that we had grown up. I don't even think that the parents nowadays could go through what they have already gone through. I thank and praise God that both of my parents, through what we have put them through, still have a sound mind and still here with us today out of the 50 years of their marriage. Once again, I say, I thank God for my parents and I take my hats off to them again. Thank you and God continue to bless.
But I want to tell my family about the love of God. I can't get off into detail because this is an interview for my mother and father 50th anniversary. Mm-hmm. And I thank the Lord for blessing them to get to this point. Hallelujah.
Now we're back in the States in Fort Buckles, and glad to be back in the States. And I'd like to say happy 50th anniversary to my mother.
Let's just tell it like it is. The two of them have been superb. And then trying to raise a family of 14, 15, 16, 17 kids or whatever and never had to go and get them out of jail and all kind of trouble, this and that, it's a blessing. You had to have strong parents, and that's the only thing that I could say. The parents had to be extremely strong. The proof is in the pudding.
I'm gonna sit there and listen. He don't like for two people to be talking at the same time when he's talking. Now he always have told me, you can sing together, but you cannot talk together. So then he'll stop and just listen and look at you and say, well, are you finished? He'll say, are you finished? But that's still there. That's just teaching us how to, you know, the things that you're supposed to do right. And I just thank God for my mom and my dad.
My parents for sticking together throughout these 50 years. I think it was important to all of us that they stayed together because they were the nucleus and the center of our family. I know it's hard and the 50 years hadn't been easy, but I just want both of them to know that I thank God for them and I love both of them equally. And I've taken this opportunity, as we all have, to say happy anniversary. And again, we love you.
Making the person I am, and you are the best, and don't let anybody say you're not. I'll tell you what, without you, we wouldn't have 14 kids. Today and tonight, I hope this day will be an enjoyable day for both of you, because you deserve the best.
He got a heart of gold too, you know. I mean, he's a good man, and he always, you know, every time I say, Kenny, give me $5 when I'm down at my last dollar. He always there for me, and my brother Nuck always there for me. And he, you know, when I had my divorce, he was there for me. He really bought Tramiel and Tori some clothes. I mean, he did a lot. I don't have no complaints about my family. I think it's the best family you can ever have. And Jason, he always been there too. So, that's all I have to say, because I can go on and on and on. So just want to say I hope everybody have a nice night tonight, and may God bless you all.
Having all these kids and things, it's just tough on you. Some people go right on in and have a baby, but I've been here all night trying to have a baby. And I don't see how I had all those kids. I said, by the help of the Lord. But I thank God for them. Mm-hmm. I thank God for each and every one. Each and one of my grandchildren, and I thank you for my great-great-grandchildren, old Chappy. That's my little boy there. Yes, yes. He is hitting me to death talking. He just got so much to say, my little Chappy. And I enjoy them. They love me, and I love them. And I thank the Lord for each and every one of them.
I used to think that I could not go home, and life was nothing but an awful song. But now I know the meaning of true love. I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. If I can see just believe it. There's nothing to it. I believe I can fly. I believe I can touch the sky. I think about it every night and day. Spread my wings and fly away. I believe I can soar. I know it starts inside of me. Oh, oh, if I can see it, then I can be it. If I just believe it, there's nothing to it. I believe I can fly. I believe I can touch the sky.
Ah! Yeah.